how you got here, but let's talk about Nephrodite, what you're doing, where you're at, that kind of thing.
Thanks. So, my co-founder, Hip Nguyen, he goes by Bob. He's a pediatric urologist. And we have together taken care of a lot of patients with kidney failure. Their kidneys, for a variety of reasons, have stopped working, or they were removed because of cancer, but they find themselves without the ability to clear toxins. We have two filters in our body that clear toxins. One is our paired organs, the kidneys, and the other is the liver. Okay. And when your kidneys stop working, that is incompatible with life. And so the only option available to patients is to undergo dialysis. And the meaning of dialysis is literally to filter and cleanse the blood. Dialysis was pioneered in 1943. And I guess it's interesting, but not to us as we've learned more about the space, but dialysis hasn't seen any innovation to any appreciable degree since 1943. And it was that concept that surrounded the epicenter, if you will. It was the epicenter of the crux of the problems that both Bob and I saw our patients experiencing by having dialysis. And the current form of dialysis is intermittent, meaning you only get your blood filtered and cleansed about three times a week. And that's in contrast to our kidneys that are working 24/7. And so as a result of the only getting intermittent dialysis, patients sort of feel really good when they get dialysis. And then over the next day and a half, they start to develop those toxins and they feel really bad. And those constant peaks and troughs or ebbs and flows are what make not patients not only feel miserable, but they feel miserable as a reflection of what's going on inside their bodies. It is literally wreaking havoc inside their bodies. So that was the genesis of Bob and I sort of saying, we've got to do something different than what's been going on for the last 80 years.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. So what Bob and I wanted to address in our device as we started thinking about it was, so the first point to make is, Bob and I were visiting professors at German Aerospace, and during a tour, they had shown us a concept, but a real prototype concept of an implantable heart. Mm-hmm. And that implantable heart, it was literally amazing. And you know, both of he and I joke, I mean, what else would you expect from German engineering, right? I mean, yeah. it was really great.
Right.
And as we started looking at it, Bob kind of looked at me and said, wow, it's so fascinating. Imagine if we were to miniaturize this heart. And then I looked back at him and said, well, yeah, maybe use it as a dialysis device. And so we sort of instantly, and by the way, we had never met before. We had sort of first met at that time. Okay. He was in Harvard at Boston Children's, and I was in Ann Arbor or something like that. So we sort of sat down and started talking about things. And the first thing we sort of said was, well, if we make a miniaturized pump, if you will, like a mechanical dialysis pump. And again, dialysis means to filter. He said, well, what are the attributes that we would need? And so we started going over that. We'd need a housing. We need some membranes in order to allow the blood to be cleared through the membranes. The concept of our kidneys, there's two purposes. One is to filter and one is to exchange fluid. And that's why our kidneys, when it filters the blood, which is about 20% of our blood volume every minute, when it filters our blood, there's a byproduct of that blood, which is water from the filtration process. And that is excreted in the form of urine because it goes down to our bladders and excreted. So you can't really think about a new or novel dialysis device unless you address both the filtering and the fluid exchange. So he said, we've got to figure out a way to filter it, because he said, what's going on right now is patients have grafts put in their arms. And I think you've seen patients with arm grafts. It's blown up. The blood vessels are kind of, you know, really big and monstrous. And what they do at dialysis, they put a needle in that graft And they use that graft in their arm, it's called a fistula, they use that to use for dialysis over about 3 or 4 hours. So Bob said, there's a right way and a wrong way, and accessing the blood supply, the vascular space, is the right way to go. It's very efficient, it makes sense. Our kidneys are connected to our blood supply. So he said, our device has to be connected to our blood supply. And he said, but there's another form of dialysis called peritoneal or abdominal dialysis. And that is really inefficient. And there's a lot of complications along with that. And Bob said, we've got to be able to filter the fluid, but not do it in the abdomen. We got to stay away from the abdomen. So he said, why don't we put the device in the pelvis, hook it up to one of the arteries in the pelvis, but then have an exchange of fluid happen outside of the body with the tube coming out, where we could exchange bags of fluid to allow for an exchange. So the fluid's coming in and the blood's circulating, and the fluid and the blood are exchanging toxins for nutrients. And so what's staying in the blood is good, and what's going out into the bag is bad. And so we have a combination of an implantable dialysis device that's always 24/7 implanted. You can't access it once it's been surgically put in, but we have a port connected to a bag that a patient would wear on a vest. And that bag would hold fluid that connects to the device inside, and that would allow for the exchange of fluid. So it's kind of like a hybrid wearable, mm-hmm. with an implantable. So it's kind of like two parts to our device.
Yeah.